So it's my pleasure to introduce Donald Leroux, who's going to be the host for this morning's plenary session on energy. Donald has a degree in mining engineering, 1985, from Laval University here in Quebec City. He did graduate work that took him to Australia, the CSIRO, where he worked on liberation modeling. From 91 to 2005, he worked as a metallurgist and a mineral processing team leader in various Noranda Falconbridge divisions. 2005, he accepted to become director of technology for CAREM, that's here in Quebec City. Some of you will have a chance to visit those facilities on Friday. CAREM undertakes industrial R&D for its partners, and he is currently head of metal accounting software for Triple Point Technology. He's been and is a director on the board of directors of CMP, the Canadian Mineral Processors Division of CIM, and of course you know he is also co-chair of the technical program for IMPC 2016. So you've got a good pedigree there, Donald. Please come up and host this morning's session.
Thanks, Jim. Good morning, everyone. Bonjour, buenos dias, bon dia a todos, and welcome to this second plenary of on energy management. This morning, we're going to have two great speakers and thought-provoking speakers, and in a few minutes, Mary Stewart and Andrew Cooper will share with us their fascinating views on energy management in the minerals industry. Listen carefully. I mean, you're very likely going to walk out of this plenary with a different point of view on this important issue that is energy management in mineral processing. Before we get started, though, I would just like to take a moment to say a few words about a man for whom mineral processing, from all angles, was a passion. This man used to teach here in this very city of Quebec at Laval University the science and technology of mineral processing. Through his passion and great knowledge, he influenced the development of many young professional engineers, including myself. And I wouldn't be surprised if other of his former students were sitting in this room this morning. The man also greatly contributed to advancing the science and technology of mineral processing through numerous publications and presentations at international conferences such as this one. Many of you, you know, international delegates mostly, got to know him through those events and afterwards became good friends of him. So those of you all already recognize the man I'm talking about. I'm talking about Professor Gilles Barbary. Our friend Gilles, passed away in October 1989, a few days after his 46th anniversary. If he were still with us, he would only be 73. He would be full of energy and without a doubt sitting in this room, very likely on the front row, preparing himself for the question period. Prior to the Congress, he would have prepared half a dozen presentations and papers that he would be looking forward to present in front of the audience. He would be looking, and for those of you who know him, know that he would have delivered all of his speeches with a skillful blend of rigor and humor. So, Gilles, you influence the lives of those who had a great fortune of studying and working close to you. We'll be grateful forever for your generosity and friendship, so we miss you. Our first speaker this morning is Mr. Andrew Cooper. Our first speaker this morning is Dr. Mary Stewart. Wrong side of the page. Mary graduated in chemical engineering from the Wits University in Johannesburg in South Africa. She got also a PhD degree from the University of Cape Town. She joined the University of Sydney, Australia as a senior researcher in 1998. In 2005, she joined Energetics, and she's been with them since. She started off as a principal for mining, but through the years, she accepted position with increasing level of responsibility. She has now become the general manager of Energetics. So we're very fortunate to have Mary with us this morning. Just for those of you who don't know the company, Energetics is a consulting firm specializing in energy management and climate change, and offer the services to the government and to the ASX 200 companies, which of course includes the largest mining companies of Australia. The title of her presentation is Energy Productivity, the Untapped Opportunity in Mineral Processing. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Dr. Mary Stewart.
Thank you very much for that introduction, Donald. Before I start, I'd like to say a sincere thank you to Prof. Finch and to the organizing committee for inviting me to speak here. It's an amazing opportunity, and I hope you enjoy the ride. I'm going to be talking to you about energy productivity, the untapped opportunity in minerals processing. Just to give you a bit of a background about Energetics, we've been around for 30 years. As Donald said, consult to the top 200 on the Australian Stock Exchange. Typically, we work with companies who spend around 10 million or more on energy a year. We work across all of the economy. We don't necessarily work with domestic users, but other than that, we work across all sectors of the economy. With the downturn and the end of the super cycle, I've had the great experience of working with the banks and the retail sector, which has been quite exciting. Energetics is an end-to-end energy provider, so we help clients procure energy, we help them negotiate their electricity contracts, we work on their gas contracts, we do site assessments and help them reduce energy consumption on site, we work on energy and greenhouse reporting, both mandatory and voluntary, and in support of sustainability reporting, and we work on corporate policy and government policy. So we do work from the bottom to the top, and a lot of what I'm going to be talking to you today is gleaned from doing that for the big miners for the last 10 years. So firstly, I'm going to look at the difference between energy efficiency and energy productivity and ask if it does actually make a difference. I'm going to move on to looking at what your energy dollar buys and actually what you're spending your money on. Look at the different opportunities for reducing your energy spend, and then pose, just take a small amount of time to speak to a potential research question or something I'd like to see researchers paying attention to. You've got to know that energy productivity is becoming important to the sector when the management consultants start to publish on it. We know that productivity is a significant focus in the sector at the moment, and energy productivity is central to many of those conversations. So what's the difference between energy efficiency and energy productivity, and does it tell us anything different? Energy efficiency is typically quoted in kilowatt hours or kilojoules per ton of material moved or per ton ROM. We start looking at energy intensity when we talk about kilowatt hours per ton of product. But energy productivity is looking at your kilowatt hours per dollar value of product produced or potentially dollar value of kilowatt hours invested per product value. As I said, does this really matter? Does changing these make any difference to how we view companies, how we view products, and how we develop policy? In order to try and work this out, this is work I did for the ASSE, the Australian Alliance to Save Energy, which is looking at doubling the Australian energy productivity. So multiplying the value of product produced for dollar energy invested by a factor of two over 20 years. There's similar programs running in Europe and in the States, and energy productivity as a focus is starting to gain global traction. So I looked at it for the ASSE, trying to find in information sets that were defined according to the same boundary conditions was not easy. Energy information, I looked at the GRI reports, the sustainability reports, and the Carbon Disclosure Project, which has a focus on emissions, but for about 6 years also gathered energy cost information. Financial information is much easier to get hold of. Because of financial reporting rules, your information sets are consistent and you understand the basis of reporting, and globally they're pretty similar. When I looked at the corporate energy productivity information, I was surprised by the variability across the big diverse miners. But because of the difference in the commodities that these companies hold, you can't really say that Rio Tinto is a better performer, say, than Xstrata, just because the numbers are different. What you can see, however, is that Rio Tinto appears to have much tighter control on their energy productivity than does Xstrata, for example. This is impacted by whatever commodities they invested and divested from over that time. But we can start getting an indication of management and control from this information. Commodity energy productivity was much more complicated. Trying to find energy price information broken down by commodity was very, very difficult. I looked at sustainability reports, CDP reports, production reports, annual reports. Energetics holds a lot of this information internally. But trying to find information that I could put into the public domain that was based on public information sets was challenging. The one set of information that I could readily work out what the commodity energy intensity was came from the energy efficiency opportunities information set that was built in Australia. The Energy Efficiency Opportunities Act required any user of more than 0.1 petajoules of energy to do a detailed assessment of all of their site energy use and look for energy efficiency improvements. It also required companies to report on total energy use by site and total opportunities identified and enacted. So this data set, which is a 7-year data set, gave me information on a site-by-site basis, and therefore I could build commodity information, admittedly for Australian companies, for Australian sites only. I allied this with quarterly production information, which is very detailed, and you can see exactly what companies are producing. And this was what really surprised me, because in my mind, when I look at energy consumption in the sector, I put the bulk commodity guys together, so coal and iron ore have very similar types of opportunities. The middle concentration, so the base metals, have similar energy opportunities. And then the precious metals, so gold and platinum, have similar opportunities. So that's how I'm accustomed to seeing the sector. But when I looked at the commodity energy productivity, and admittedly this covers a lot of the super cycle, you can see why BHP and Rio were printing money. They were making an enormous amount of product value for all of the energy that they were investing. And gold and coal sort of grouped together. And that's extraordinary from my perspective, just looking at the difference of processing product. Is it possible to see those three materials in the same group? And then alumina, obviously, because of its energy intensity, is sitting much, much lower. So what does this productivity information tell me? It's more useful at a corporate or policy level. I don't think building KPIs to impose on companies are sensible. I think companies can use this information to get a better idea of how they're managing energy and as part of an energy management program. You can look at the performance between companies, but it's better to use the performance between sites. And it does start to give you, if you look on a commodity basis, which commodities you should be looking at with respect to improvement, and then also which sites you should be looking at in more detail. But all it is really a strategy level piece of information, and it helps you guide management system development. So that's when we go into more detail and start looking at what your energy is really buying. And this comes from Deloitte this year. I try to find something scary that said energy prices are going to double in the next 2 decades. No one's willing to print that, but everyone is pointing to an inevitable increase in energy prices. And that's going to be across the board and globally, irrespective of whether their carbon price is coming in, energy prices are going to increase. But what does your electricity dollar really buy? And the reason that I'm focusing on electricity here and not the total energy draw of a mine site is that electricity is typically what powers minerals processing plants. We don't have to look at diesel other than that diesel is used in on-site generation. So this is for a typical Australian electricity contract. There are the retail charges, what you pay to the electricity retailer, which typically are a function of being able to access the network. And then there's also peak shoulder and off-peak. Sorry, the retailer is peak shoulder and off-peak and consumption. Your network also charges you both fixed and variable amounts. Your fixed costs are associated with things like metering and monitoring. While contestable, you typically pay for them on a day-by-day basis. Capacity charges, which is about your peak power draw, and then your kilowatt hour demand charges, which is about access to the network. In Australia, there are environmental charges, the LRET and the SRET, which relate to the renewable energy target. We have a 20% renewable energy production target for Australia by 2020, and this is the RET is used to support renewable energy projects. There are also other contestable things in the electricity account, which you can only change the price of when you're negotiating your contract. What does this look like when you start looking at it in the context of a mine site? So here we have 18 months worth of production data for an open cut mine. And this is what 15 minute interval data looks like for that mine over those 18 months. You can assume that sort of 3/4 of the way through there was a bit of a shut. But the one thing I see here is that there isn't a point at which electricity drops significantly to, you don't get anywhere near zero. There's always a baseload draw at the site. And use is very variable. So if I apply my time of use charges, there is no shoulder charge at the site. You can see that it's sort of split, the peak and the off-peak pricing. There isn't much time of use change during the day. But if I look at this and break it down even further, we can see the kilowatt hour charges, both for the retailer and for the network, do dominate, but there are fixed prices that are very significant, and there are also the KVA charges, which can't be underestimated. And the KVA charges are particularly important when we're looking at big pieces of kit on site, like the mill. In Australia, if you have a peak power usage, so you have a significant peak, you can spend the next 12 months paying for it. So you've got a KVA charge that might cost you $20,000 in the month in which it occurs. You then pay that $20,000 every month for 12 months. Until you can prove to the retailer that you're not, sorry, to the network, that you're not going to cause that type of peak and disturbance to their network again, they charge you for that peak. You can reset. But it takes typically 12 months to reset those peak demand charges. So that KVA, those inrush charges, are not insignificant and seldom seen by site. So a lot of the contracts that we try to get hold of are held by procurement, off-site, and even out of the country. So BHP Billiton Procurement is in Singapore, and if I'm at a site in the Bowen Basin, I cannot see what their contract looks like. And it's very difficult for me to work out exactly what energy cost is to the site other than just a bottom-up budget number, which is a constant per kilowatt hour. Now we're looking at opportunities for improvement. So there's the spend on site. How do we go about addressing it? I've cited the Coalition for Eco-Efficient Comminution, the SEEK numbers here, that indicate that a 15% improvement in energy productivity is possible by adopting best practice. There are a lot of changes that can be made to energy efficiency on site without significant capital expense. So we go back to these numbers and seeing, getting an idea of where the total energy spend is going. And if we group them, we can start allocating them. So the demand charges, you can address by programs on site, you can address by power factor correction, you can address by management systems. The kilowatt hour charges, you can address with energy efficiency projects as well as through contracts. And then the fixed charges, you can only address through a contract. And if you're holding a 3-year contract and you've negotiated a poor price, you're going to be paying that for 3 years. So if you start looking at where your energy is being spent, you can get a better idea of the type of programs you should be looking at when you try to address the spend. It doesn't cost very much to renegotiate a contract. Maybe $25,000 for a site. And if you get $1 million improvement on an annual basis, it's a good investment. And it's that type of thinking that we're starting to see increasingly come through in the Australian sector because there's been a blowout in the SRET and the LRET values. But there's other things that you can do that don't require significant capital investment. And this is looking at the power factor of admittedly a relatively old gold mine. But demonstrating, so the power factor is the difference between virtual and real power. I never liked electrical engineering. I couldn't understand why they used imaginary numbers to describe something that was obviously real to me. But the power factor is the difference between virtual and real power. And real power is stuff that you use, and the virtual power is what you lose through typically things like harmonics in your site. So this is alternating current, and if you've got phases out, and if you've got noisy equipment, you've got lots and lots of little motors doing unreliable stuff, you can decay your power factor on site. And the amount of power that you're actually using is not as great as the amount of power that you're supplying. And what this analysis showed was that even if you did a small amount of power factor correction on site, you could save a significant amount of money. This is particularly pertinent to off-grid sites, because the usual way that you address a power factor problem is not only through checking the health of your reticulation system, but typically you're building capacitance. And the capacitance, becomes a buffer and starts settling out some of the disruption. You can, on off-grid sites, use some of your on-site generation as a reactive capacitance. So you keep some spinning reserve, and it means you don't have to invest in capacitors, and it helps you better manage the health of your network. So for a $50,000 investment, the site was able to save in excess of $1 million a year. But benchmarking is a really useful way to start looking for opportunities and to start pinpointing where you should be investing your effort. We're going to delve a little bit into the coal sector here. That's because it's the best benchmarking information set I have. Don't worry, we'll be back to hard rock soon. So this is looking at the total performance of 130 coal mine sites and starting to look at the performance of a single site relative to that. What's useful about this is not only looking at the absolute values, but looking at the range of values that are being recorded. So we can see the range of performance for the database there. And you can also see that the range of performance for the site I'm interested in is much, much tighter. So that tells me the type of management program I can look at for the site. They have good control. They probably have good information sets, and they're going to be much more sophisticated. You can look at different types of improvements to a site where you just have absolutely no control over your energy and a very broad spread of performance. But then we can break it down further and start looking at across the data set, the total energy consumption of different pieces of equipment and how the site looks relative to that. There's a significant impost of pumping in the sector. A lot of this data set was built during the floods in Queensland, and there was a lot of water pumping going on. This data set would suggest that maybe you start looking at your pumping as a first opportunity. The Seek Energy Curve project is another way of benchmarking and enables you to benchmark the performance of your comminution circuit relative to the performance of others. Just a quick word on Seek. They're a not-for-profit. They have a voluntary workforce. And what they're on about is trying to make information available globally to support the business case for change in the sector. The energy curve methodology looks at the energy intensity, the energy efficiency of a plant on the y-axis, and the x-axis gives you an indication of the total quantum of production for the site. At the moment, there's 16 databases in it. JK Tech, AusIMM, many databases in there, and there's a growing number of sites being recorded. But does this actually tell you anything? Are there improvements that can be made? And do we see a variance in performance of, in comminution across globally? And yes, there is. What's interesting for me in this is that you can look at a sort of energy intensity, an energy efficiency indicator. And if I look at an energy intensity indicator for the same site, I get quite a different performance. So only looking at energy efficiency would suggest that the site's got quite a significant amount of improvement to do because it's a median operator. But if we look at energy productivity, they're actually not doing as badly as it looks because the production amount that they're getting for the energy that they're investing is good. Just to give you an indication of the spread of information in the SEEK database at the moment, copper is obviously well represented, as is gold. And relative to IEA, International Energy Agency information, around 0.3% of total energy consumption globally has been considered in this data set. We've seen companies using this information to work out, if I have limited capital and I'm looking at improving my comminution circuits, which one should I invest my energy in? And in putting three or four of their comminution circuits, putting that information into the SEEK database, they've been able to work out which of their sites is going to give them best return and focus their energy on that site. The challenge that I've had, so I've done about 100 site assessments, typically under EEO, but also for corporate programs. And what is intensely frustrating is that you come up with NPV positive projects that will save the sites a lot of money and they don't get enacted. I had one that I will never forget and I hope one day to make this project happen. It was a $500,000 a year project. It would save, it had a 6-month payback. So it was a $500,000 project, 6-month payback. In the first year it would have saved them $500,000, in the second year $1 million. It wasn't implemented because the savings weren't big enough. It was too much trouble. And there are significant barriers to change in the sector. Actually making companies and sites address energy efficiency is a challenging exercise. But as you take apart these barriers to change, all of them point to risk. And what we're finding some traction on is by increasing that concept of risk. So if we explain to them the risk associated with inaction, we are starting to get some traction moving forward. In other sectors, as I say, I'm not wholly looking at the mining sector nowadays, most energy efficiency projects are NPV negative. And in those sectors, this is work done by the Rocky Mountain Institute. It's looking at deep retrofits of buildings. They look at other ways to build the business case and what other additionalities you have to incorporate in your NPV to get it to be NPV positive and to convince companies to act. We're getting better at these types of calculations, both in the mining sector and elsewhere. But as I said, typically mining energy efficiency projects are NPV positive. So including all of those externalities isn't necessarily helping me. What is helping me is looking at what energy efficiency can be seen as a multiplier for. So if we reduce energy consumption, we also typically slowing a motor, stopping a motor, which reduces work hours, it reduces maintenance, it reduces labor, it reduces having to get an electrician on site. Remote mine sites, that's not always easy. So there's a significant upside to an energy saving project. And the multipliers that we're seeing are the sort of 7 to 10 times on things like haul trucks and conveyors. We're also starting to see energy productivity being used as a proxy for site productivity. So if I go back to my coal mine data set and see a site that's got a performance range that's quite wide, I know before I get there that management is probably fragmented. that it's not a tidy site, that there's coal lying around everywhere, and that they're using their sumps as overflows and just using them, they're pumping from there the whole time. So you can use energy as a proxy for site performance in many indicators. And the good thing about energy is it's quite easy to measure. Measuring maintenance efficiency, measuring the value of getting an electrician to site is not so easy. Measuring electricity is a lot less trouble. And increasingly, we're seeing companies focus on energy productivity as they push their site productivity programs forward. But how does this look in the bigger picture of my world? Energetics does a lot of work on carbon pricing. We're advising the Australian government on what carbon trading could look like or should look like. If we look at energy efficiency and energy productivity, what it's really about is reducing your site demand. It's getting your site demand better controlled and more manageable. So this will reduce any need for installed capacity on site, and it reduces the demands on an aging reticulation system. It also makes the business case for renewable energy easier. So if you're looking at 10% of your site energy coming from renewable energy, it can cut the cost of that in half because it reduces the total demand of the site and therefore the total requirement for supply. And that's the real winner for the sector, because if we look at renewable energy and the price and how you pay for renewable energy, you typically pay renewable energy off in 7 to 10 years. It hasn't looked that good relative to typical life of mine of 7 to 10 years because the energy price has been significantly higher. But if you look at a potential extension of mine life, for any extension, you're essentially getting energy for free. And what we've started to see is an industry that's much more flexible about the timelines that it's willing to look at. Because if you get energy for free towards the end of your life of mine, you can spend 10 years scratching around the edges and exploiting low-grade ore because it's your cost benefits working out. And the application, the Sandfire renewable hybrid renewable diesel is a very good example of a site actually looking at that and saying, well, I'm building a business case for 7 years, but in actual fact, I'm pretty sure I'm going to be here for 12. And my business case for those 12 years is exceptional. And we're seeing a changing of the guard now. We're going to see hybrid energy systems on mine sites increasingly, which is a change I'm looking forward to. And now we come to the research challenge. And what I would like to see someone looking at in more detail is not just looking at encoding energy price in an optimization algorithm as a dollar value per kilowatt hour or a dollar value per gigajoule, because energy costs are not linear. They're a function of kilowatt hours and time, as well as KVA. And we need to, somewhere along the line, if we're going to optimize costs of technology, start taking into account the variable value of electricity. The interesting one is time of use charges, trying to convince a GM on a site that they should turn their mill off at the peak power time is not an argument that's easy to win. But if we had the algorithms and we had research that supported the business case across a much more flexible energy price model, it would be very useful. So where have we been today? We've looked at energy efficiency, energy intensity, and the difference between the two. We looked at what your energy dollar buys you. You're spending on KVA, you're spending on kilowatt hours, and you've got fixed costs. We've looked at different opportunities and highlighted the importance of benchmarking to pinpoint where you should be investing your efforts. And then, as I said, we've posed a small research question, which is what happens with non-linear, time-dependent energy pricing. I'm going to leave it there and hand over to Don.
This very insightful presentation. We're going to open the floor now for questions and comment. Are there anybody in the room willing to break the ice? Gentleman over there. Yes, hi. Please.
Mike Dry from Arithmetic. Hi, Mary. Long time no see. a question. In what you do, does energy storage come into it.
Yes, definitely. And not an easy, necessarily an easy example in the mining sector, but the uptake of batteries globally has surprised everyone. It's outstripping the reduction in cost of the battery itself because of the ability to use batteries to shift your time of use and to move you from just being on the brink of peak to using outside of peak. So battery technology and the advance in battery technology is going to be a huge change. The value in understanding your energy consumption in detail on site is it allows you to optimize the size of the batteries and the size of renewables relative to whatever diesel or electricity you're going to use as well. And we've seen quite a lot of overspecification of battery sizes, and getting the optimal balance between battery size, on-site capacitance to manage your power factor and your renewable energy is that's where we're working at the moment, and those are the projects we like to do.
Gentleman over there, please.
Wait a second. Will you get the microphone in a second?
Thank you.
Just because I imagine you do a lot of going back to sites and audits, but do you get much involved in new site design to try to make it more energy efficient from the get-go?
Yes. We have developed the energy efficiency design guidelines for a number of companies. We typically go back in support of those and check. So either we're working on behalf of the project proponents, so Rio or Glencore, and making sure that the design guidelines have been applied correctly during design, going back and checking the designer's decision-taking, why they've taken those types of decisions. The biggest challenge we have is ensuring that specified technology is actually put on site. So the big decisions around what does my comminution circuit look like, what is the size of my sag mill, those typically stick. But keeping variable speed drives, soft starts, high efficiency motors in that final plan at the end is very difficult. As soon as they want to, we're 5% over budget, let's take out the VSDs. That is a significant lost opportunity, and we saw a lot of that happening, particularly in iron ore, when they were just trying to build those plants as fast as they could.
Thank you. We have another one in the corner.
Yeah, one quick comment on the storage of energy. What I see some people doing is that when the energy is low, I mean the price is low, you just grind a lot. So you prepare, you use it when to grind. So when you have the stockpile, that's where you store the energy. The question for you is basically, what are we doing to integrate the mine and the mill so the blast and the energy that you use in the grinding circuits or maybe changing the grinding mode with precarcification of some sort to really decrease the amount of energy drastically rather than looking at the same sag mills and looking at the same process? What is the future looking to reduce radically the energy in the mining industry?
There's two questions there. The future to reduce energy use in the mines significantly is move less material. And looking at, for example, the South African gold industry and in-situ leaching, not actually moving the rock in the first place. Looking at that and extending it further, the development of throw blasting and using your cheapest form of energy on your site, which is your blasting energy, to do as much of the work as possible. It's not necessary. Energetics doesn't do technology development. We help companies to identify what are their best opportunities. And we do use the what is your cheapest energy, blasting energy, diesel energy, electricity. That's typically the cascade of energy costs. So use your blast energy as well as possible. Use it to fragment. Move as little material as possible. I'm not going to say what the next big thing in comminution is. I am going to suggest that if we look at productivity measures, as opposed to looking at intensity or efficiency measures, it does give us a different view, which is stop grinding so much, because your marginal return on investment for that additional grinding energy is not necessarily paying it off. It's a difficult argument to win with a site GM, which is turn back your mill and don't grind too much, because the total economics of this aren't working out when they're accustomed to chasing recovery. So I think what I'm saying is I'm waiting for the members of this audience to bring the new technologies so that we can try and win the fight with the mine managers to do things differently.
Thank you. Please.
Hi, I Alessandro Navarra, Universidad Católica del Norte. My question is, given the large time frames that we're dealing with, often 7, 10 or more years in a mine life, to what extent is geological uncertainty taken into account? Things like the potential hardness of the rock on longer distances, and I wonder if therein may be part of the argument for more flexible plant designs. Could you comment on that?
We are seeing some increase in looking at flexible plant design. As I said, during the super cycle, which is when most of current new plant was built, it was really about getting product out the gate. And a lot of people just took a design from 1970 and built it. So I think we have a current set of stock that could be limiting. One of the reasons we're excited about renewable energy on site is you pay for your energy equipment when times are good, because when you start a mine, you go after the richest material that's closest to the plant and you make your most money. So let's pay off energy when times are good, so you have a resilient energy infrastructure to support an aging mine where you're moving greater distances and you have more questionable geology. I don't think I can comment in much detail about design for variability. It's not something I'm seeing my clients doing very often. What we are seeing them look at, though, is our clients are trying to work out what materials they should be holding. So given the signing of the COP in Paris and the undertaking to reduce global climate emissions, what commodities do I need to hold in 2050 to be best placed to service that economy? And looking at, because if you want to be producing them in 2050, you must be exploring for them now. So increasingly we're seeing the big miners looking at what they're holding, what does it mean in the context of a carbon constrained world, and what new commodities they might invest in. And some potential divestment. I mean, if you look at South 32, that's the carbon intensive assets of BHP Billiton. One could call that a carbon divestment. Looking at companies who have consciously gone after coking coal and not thermal coal, because coking coal isn't really replaceable in use, but somewhere along the line, thermal coal is no longer going to be used. So the companies, the coal miners know that they have a finite life on their product. There's a sustained attack from the natural gas guys who will spend the rest of the next 2 decades proving that they're better than coal. And that's what we're seeing happening at the big corporates, is trying to work out where they need to place themselves in 2030 and 2050.
Great. Well, we're going to have to cut it off here. Mary, thank you very much for sharing your ideas and interesting insight on this very topic of energy management. Thank you very much. So our second speaker this morning is Mr. Andrew Cooper. Andrew is a professional engineer, a certified energy manager, and a certified measurement and verification professional. He graduated in electrical engineer from the University of KwaZulu in South Africa. Andrew is passionate about minimizing waste, maximizing efficiency, and optimizing the use of resources. He's currently the energy specialist at the New Afton Gold Mine in British Columbia, Canada. He led the implementation of the ISO 50001 standard at the New Afton mine that became the first mine in North America to achieve this certification.
In 2015, Andrew won the International Energy Manager of the Year Award from the AEEE. Andrew had led the implementation of a wide cross-section of projects, many of which have resulted in significant energy savings. The title of his presentation is, What Are We Waiting For? The Secret to Successful Energy Management. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Andrew Cooper.
Energy management at New Afton is self-sustaining, something that is done by all employees on a day-to-day basis as part of what we do at New Gold. There is a high level of energy awareness at New Afton, and everyone works to continually improve energy performance in everything they do. Energy matters at New Afton. This is our vision for energy management. This is what's written into our energy policy. And this is what I say to myself first thing every morning, every day at work. The underlying objective behind our vision is that energy conservation is a decision by all employees to be efficient and conserve energy in everything they do, and then acting on that decision. Have we all made this decision yet? If not, what are we waiting for? Thank you, Donald, for that kind introduction. And thank you, Mary, for a very informative presentation. Reading through your very impressive bio and picking up just a hint of an accent, I see we originate from a similar neck of the woods. It seems like the master plan to infiltrate all corners of the world is actually working. And good morning to all of you here today. I trust you're enjoying the Congress thus far, that your coffee has had time to kick in, and that you're not too bleary-eyed after the Metsoc celebration last night. But before we continue, I must tell you that I recently had jaw surgery and ended up with an expansion plate in my mouth and a very attractive gap in my front teeth. This has affected my speech somewhat, but that should not be a problem because folks struggled to understand me before the surgery. And I thought I was doing pretty okay until I phoned the hotel here in Quebec City to confirm my reservation. After pressing 2 for English and speaking for a few seconds, the reservation person interrupted me and said, "Sorry, sir, do you speak English?" I sincerely hope you have less of a problem understanding what I have to say today. Professor James Finch and his team have put together a very impressive event. And I quote, "With over 600 plus oral presentations and 150 posters being absorbed by 1,000, I believe it's more, delegates from more than 50 countries around the world, this edition of IMPC promises to be one of the largest since its inception." That inception was in London, England in 1952, with 39 presentations and 336 delegates. It seems a small acorn has grown into a massive oak tree. Having an entire plenary dedicated to energy is a sign of the times and aligns well with the Congress theme of processing for all, meeting technical, environmental, and social challenges. Apart from the obvious, tangible environmental impacts of mining and mineral processing, there is also a hidden, possibly far more sinister environmental and social impact. This is as a result of the greenhouse gases emitted from the energy we use to extract, process, and dispose of the ore we mine. Mineral processing itself is an extremely energy-intensive process, According to the Coalition for Eco-Efficient Comminution, comminution is on average the biggest energy step in mining. This means that people and companies associated with mineral processing, basically most of us here today, are uniquely positioned to positively or negatively, as the case may be, to impact energy consumption and the associated greenhouse gas emissions. In this session, I'm going to reveal the simple secret to successful energy management and present a fundamental approach to improving energy efficiency using the first ISO 50001 implementation at a mine in North America as an example. As you've probably gathered, I'm not originally from North America. I'm originally from Bulawayo, the second largest city of Zimbabwe, with a population of around 750,000 people. It's a little red dot on the map. Now, water was not the most abundant resource, and we often had very strict water rationing. Some months, especially just before the annual rains, it would get so hot and so dry that when the traffic lights turned green, the goats would try to eat them. And I believe it's because of this background that I've developed a passion for minimizing waste and maximizing the use of resources available to us. But it was only when I started working, first as an electrical engineer and then as engineering manager at this place, Sifto Salt Mine in Godridge, Ontario, reportedly the world's largest underground salt mine, that I really started to grasp the positive financial and environmental impacts of energy efficiency. It should not have come as a surprise that I ended up as the energy specialist at New Gold's New Afton mine a little over 5 years ago. Since then, it's been a whole unto your hat journey of energy management trials, tribulations, and triumphs, some of which we'll chat about today. Now, I'm not going to be talking about the sexy side of energy management, things like new technology, innovative projects, renewables. Not because I don't think they're important. They are. But I believe that we may be losing touch with the basic concept of energy conservation. Let me give you an example which builds a bit on what Mary was saying earlier. A company has an opportunity to utilize new technology to improve the energy performance of a piece of equipment. Now, it's a relatively large user, and a comprehensive feasibility study has indicated an energy saving of about 1 gigawatt hour of electricity per year. The project's going to cost about $200,000. It's going to last 10 years. It has a positive NPV, a 39% IRR, and a 2.5 year payback. Sounds pretty good. But the company has a strict 1 year payback requirement on all capital projects, so the project does not go ahead. What a lot of work for nothing. What if a group of operators decide to shut down a 5,200 horsepower conveyor system when there's no ore coming from underground? Or what if 14% of the population of Canada, 1.4% of the population of the USA, or just 0.3% of the population of India, decide to switch off an incandescent lamp, a 60-watt incandescent lamp, for just 10 minutes extra per day? Same saving, zero cost, infinite IRR. Which is better? In April this year, Canada committed to reducing greenhouse gas emissions levels by 30% from 2005 levels by the year 2030, pledging to harness the power of renewable energy to do this. Similar pledges came from the majority of the major world leaders. In many provinces, states, and countries, renewable energy is actually driving up the cost of energy due to the high prices being paid to incentivize companies to install renewable generation. We, in turn, waste this expensive renewable energy. As Kermit the Frog said many, many years ago, it's not easy being green. There's so much we can do, so easily and so cost effectively, if we just make a decision to be efficient and conserve energy in everything we do on a day-to-day basis, and then acting on that decision. Have we all made this decision yet? If not, what are we waiting for? Are we waiting for the government to do something? Here's a thought. It's not up to the government, it's up to us. As we wait, greenhouse gas levels continue to rise, putting the whole planet at risk. To paraphrase the immortal words of John Fitzgerald Kennedy, ask not what your planet can do for you, ask what you can do for your planet. Never before has this been more appropriate. We're all global citizens, and it is the responsibility of each and every one of us to utilize our scarce energy resources as responsibly as possible and to minimize the amount of greenhouse gases we emit. We cannot keep on taking this planet for granted and just accept that that's the way things are. I came across one of these how many questions recently. And this one said, how many Canadians does it take to change a light bulb? And the answer is none. They just accept them the way they are. Not to make fun of Canadians, because I am a Canadian myself, but is this not true for so many? We just accept that this is the way things are and don't question how we can do it better or more efficiently. Let me give you a personal example. At home recently, I caught myself turning on the hot water faucet to rinse soap off my hands. When I finished rinsing my hands, the water was still not hot. But I'd removed 10 to 15 seconds of hot water from the hot water heater, which had been replaced with 10 to 15 seconds of cold water, which then had to be heated up. The thing is that I did not even need hot water. So why did I use the hot water faucet? Then I asked myself, why is the hot water faucet on the left-hand side? I Googled that question and discovered that in the 1900s, when indoor plumbing was introduced, cold water was brought into the home via a hand pump. Since most people were right-handed, the hand pump was placed on the right-hand side of the sink. With the advent of hot water, the hot water faucet was placed to the left-hand side because that's where there was room. We have questioned this, we've accepted this for years, and yet how many of us have questioned if there is a better or more efficient way? If you are right-handed, and the majority of us, 90% of the world, are right-handed, you would generally hold something in your right hand and lean to the left-hand faucet to wash, rinse, or fill it. And what's on the left-hand side? The hot water faucet. Maybe it's time for the faucets to switch sides. That may be as probable as a Liverpool supporter cheering for Manchester United, a Montreal Canadian supporting the Toronto Maple Leafs, or a Republican becoming a Democrat. Huh. Maybe it is possible. Do we go about the mining and mineral processing business just accepting that that is the way things are and not questioning how we can do it more efficiently? For most of you in this room, attending a congress like this, where there is a huge focus on doing things better, probably not. But walk around any mine or processing plant, find something that does not seem right, and ask, why are you doing it that way? I'd be willing to bet that the 90% of the time the answer would be, because that's how we've always done it. So how do we change this mindset? I suggest that all it takes is a decision. A decision at the corporate level, a decision at the mine level, a decision by all employees to be efficient and conserve energy in everything they do on a day-to-day basis, and then acting on that decision. This decision is the secret. Have we all made that decision yet? If not, what are we waiting for? One way to achieve this is to implement an energy management system where employee engagement and awareness, as well as the energy aspects of operations, maintenance, procurement, design, are integrated into that system. Now, there are a number of systems out there, but the one I'm going to be talking about is the ISO 50001 Energy Management System, partly because it's international with over 7,500 certified sites around the world, but primarily because I've been part of a successful implementation and have witnessed the benefits firsthand. So why do we implement ISO 50001? Well, for three reasons, really. First of all, from a company perspective, New Gold is committed to social responsibility and sustainable mining. So it was the right thing to do. With a number of sites being ISO 14001 certified, ISO 50001 was a logical step considering the relationship between energy and greenhouse gases. Secondly, energy is our second biggest expense after labor, accounting for 13% of our operational budget. Good energy management improves energy performance, which in turn reduces costs and improves profitability. And this is particularly important in these times of low metal prices. Even in a relatively small mine like New Afton, a 1% reduction in energy costs can be worth hundreds of thousands of dollars a year. And then lastly, in line with our vision, ISO 50001 focused on continual improvement of energy performance and on integrating energy management into the systems and culture of the company so it becomes what we all do on a day-to-day basis. Primarily for these three reasons, we decided to take advantage of the cost-shared assistance available for the implementation of ISO 50001 from the Natural Resources Canada and be the first mine in North America to implement ISO 50001. I read a humorous comment that one way to dramatically reduce the effect of global warming would be to change from Fahrenheit to Celsius. I'd like to believe what we're doing is a little bit more effective than that. True to our company values, the New Afton management team, as well as the New Gold Director of Environment and Corporate Social Responsibility, were very supportive of the implementation. A great deal of faith was placed in what I call my enthusiastic ignorance, because as I discovered, I had very little idea as to what we were actually undertaking. The important thing was that we made a decision and acted on it. Like the other ISO standards, ISO 50001 works on the plan, do, check, act cycle. It requires a company to do an energy review, which means analyzing energy data, identifying areas of significant energy use, and areas for energy performance improvement. Establish an energy baseline. Establish energy objectives and targets which are measurable and have timelines associated with them. establish an action plan to achieve those energy objectives and targets, implement the action plan, check performance, monitor, document, and report on all of the above. But I'm not going to bore you by delving into the detail of the standard. I'm going to share with you some lessons and insights that we've learned along the rocky road to implementation. A friend of mine was busy scrubbing and cleaning his pool when I arrived at his house one day. He said to me, "Can I share a lesson with you?" Now, he's a smart, successful guy, so I said, "Sure." He leaned in and said to me, "Andrew, never put in a pool unless someone's got a gun to your head." I sincerely hope these lessons are just a little bit more valuable than that. The first lesson is that you cannot go this alone, and you will need support. The implementation is almost a sales job. Whether you are selling the concept of ISO 50001 or that you have been voluntold to manage the implementation, you will be constantly selling. Selling ideas, selling concepts, selling energy performance improvement. The support of the management team and the employees cannot be done by an email blast, by vivid posters, or even by a very enthusiastic tweet. It's got to be done face to face, talking to people, listening to their concerns. Let them know what this will do for them, how it will make their job easier, how it will improve profitability, how it will enhance company image. Sell the benefits of the system. You're going to need help from a lot of folks in your organization, so get them on your side. Their support is essential. Get outside assistance where necessary. One example is this man, who played an invaluable part in helping us with our energy management information system. No, it's not John Malkovich, although the resemblance is remarkable, I must admit. It's Steve Boyko from ADM Systems Engineering. His cool, calm, and seemingly unfazed approach, combined with his deep knowledge of the PI system, really played an invaluable part in helping us with our work. Steve was just one of a number of experts we called on and still do call on when necessary. Avoid reinventing the wheel and piggyback where possible on existing systems. One example is with PASS. New Afton utilizes a positive attitude safety system, or PASS, for energy awareness. PASS is, in my opinion, one of the best energy awareness programs out there. So I work with the PASS team out of Kelowna to incorporate energy awareness into PASS. It starts with the small stuff like turning off lights. Folks were accustomed to PASS, and the results thus far have been encouraging. Belief. For me, this is the single biggest obstacle to overcome. Why? Because you are constantly challenging the status quo with respect to energy management. You are what Seth Godin refers to as a heretic in his book, Tribes. If you have not read this book, I strongly recommend you do so, as it really relates to what we are trying to achieve. At times, it will seem like an uphill battle. And sometimes you will be as frustrated as an upside-down cockroach. So it's important to try and maintain enthusiasm. I say our vision aloud to us, myself, every morning to help keep me motivated and help keep me focused on what we're trying to achieve. Now, this is not a get-quick-rich scheme or a lose 20 pounds in 2 weeks miracle diet. It takes time. What we have done to date has been 4 years in the making. So be patient, but persistent, and avoid trying to rush it. That said, there are times when you can't wait, and you just have to do it. The general manager at a mine I worked at used to lead the occasional mine tour. And he would often get asked the question, so how many people work here? His standard answer in his broad accent was, oh, about 10%. Despite this humorous quip and the impression that some folks are just not doing enough, at times, people will be too busy to act on your requests, so you just have to get in there and just do it anyway. I have found that if you do something in the best interest of the company, you will generally be okay. You may be burnt occasionally, but I feel it's better to have succeeded with a few scars than failed but maintained your flawless complexion. If you wait around for something to happen, you're going to be waiting a long time. While the implementation of ISO 50001 had its challenges, it was the integration of ISO 50001 into what we do on a day-to-day basis that was and is the most challenging component. During the surveillance audits in 2014 and 2015, I felt a bit like this circus performer, spinning plates on sticks, carefully orchestrating the performance, but aware that I could not carry on at that intensity and that plates would eventually begin to fall. Laurie Gregg, a consultant who assisted us with the audit, told me that ISO 50001 at New Afton was Andrew's thing, that everyone was more than happy to support it because Andrew would ensure it happened, and that ultimately Andrew was the only one really accountable for energy performance, not the people who actually used the energy. Ouch. It's true. The truth does hurt. But it is what I needed to hear, and he was absolutely right. Our energy team, which is comprised of people from each department, met regularly, but they had no clear direction. And they did not do much in terms of energy management. This, I believe, was a major flaw in our implementation. We have since established what each energy team member needs to do for ISO 50001 compliance in his or her area, and how that would be objectively measured. Energy management at New Afton is now becoming more of a team effort than Andrew's effort. So the big question I often get is, what are the benefits you've seen from ISO 50001? There are claims and studies out there which state that you will see an 8% reduction in annual energy costs. I'd be hesitant to race out there and aim for 8% right away, as it would depend on so many factors. It's like the guy who saw this beautiful Porsche in town, went home and excitedly told his wife, "For my birthday, I want something that can go from 0 to 200 in under 6 seconds. For his birthday, he got a bathroom scale. If you aim too high, too quickly, you will be disappointed. As we mine deeper or expand, we tend to use more energy. So, at New Afton, we do not set an objective for an overall reduction in energy consumption or for a reduction in energy per ton of product. We focus instead on implementing energy performance improvement initiatives which have a quantifiable amount of energy savings. This approach seems to be working for us. As you can see, our energy consumption has increased steadily since 2015. But this was expected, as we had a major addition to our grinding circuit, for example, and we've dramatically increased the number of tons processed by the mill. But greenhouse gas emissions are down, primarily as a result of reduced diesel consumption, And we even reduced the energy we used to process a ton of ore by a whopping 11.4%. The reason for this was our energy savings, which are currently saving us about 27 gigawatt hours. Or in terms we can all understand, that's about $1 million Canadian per year, or enough energy to supply 2,770 average British Columbia homes for a year. Employee awareness about energy management has increased at all levels of the organization. And for me, this is the most important and invaluable benefit. Why? Because it's people, not systems, who manage energy. Folks are constantly telling me of things they have done to save energy. And in fact, in 2014, 85% of our energy savings came as a result of employee suggestions and initiatives. One great example is an employee who came to me and said, "Andrew, can I show you a way to save energy?" "Sure," I said. He took me to the entrance of the mine operations building. "There," he said. "Where?" I asked. "The ice freezer," he said. "What about it?" I asked. He rolled his eyes back and said, "It's in the blazing hot sun every day." We are now installing a simple shade cover over the ice freezer. Now, this is a very small saving in the bigger scheme of things, but of significant importance. This employee had made a decision, was viewing things with a different perspective, and was not accepting that that is the way we have always done it. Would we have achieved these savings without ISO 50001? Possibly, but I don't believe we would have been as successful in implementing energy management into the systems and culture of the company. An investment based on a decision from a social responsibility perspective is paying back financially in spades. Our overall IRR to date is in excess of 50%. We're minimizing our impact on the environment and, importantly, we're fostering an energy conservation mindset in our employees. Who knows what benefit that will have going forward as they, in turn, share that with their children. With results like this, one wonders why more companies are not going the ISO 50001 route. I've heard plenty of excuses, but we don't have people to manage energy. But we've got no budget for energy management. But nobody's interested in energy management. But. It's not about excuses. It's about making a decision and committing to that decision. It's about getting stuck in there and making it happen. I have a personal acronym, GOYA, which is short for Get Off Your Ass, because that is what you have to do to get it done. So if you're looking to improve the way you manage energy, what can you do? The first thing I suggest would be to make a decision to be efficient and conserve energy in everything you do, a decision to get off the project-based energy management roller coaster, a decision to implement some form of energy management system. Whether you go for certification or not, ISO 50001 is an excellent standard for an energy management system. Would it be easy? Probably not. It'll probably be a rocky road, but then things worthwhile in life are seldom easy. Will it be worth it? I suggest it will be, as your environmental impact will reduce, your energy performance as well as your operational systems will improve. Are you waiting for greenhouse gas emissions to reach critically high levels? Are you waiting for energy resources to reach critically low levels? Are you waiting for everyone else to do it first? There's an old Chinese proverb which says that the best time to plant a tree was 20 years ago. The second best time is now. I'd like to suggest that the best time to conserve energy and improve efficiency was 20 years ago. The second best time is now. Imagine what sort of a difference we can all make if we just all commit to being more efficient in everything we do on a day-to-day basis and then acting on that decision. What are we waiting for? Make that decision. As I say to myself every day, energy management at New Afton is self-sustaining, something that is done by all employees on a day-to-day basis as part of what we do at New Gold. There's a high level of energy awareness at New Afton, and everyone works to continually improve energy performance in everything they do. Energy matters at New Afton. This is our vision for energy management. This is what's written into our energy policy, and this is what a decision made back in 2011 is helping us to achieve. Thank you.
Did I say passionate? All right, we're opening the floor to questions and comment. Please raise your hand and we have a roaming microphone. The ladies will go at you for so that you can ask your own questions.
I think everyone's
it's free. Jan, is there somebody at the front here? Yeah, second. Please come.
Okay, I will ask the first question.
Oh, okay.
Thank you very much for your inspirational speech. I really enjoyed it. I just wonder if you have a talk on YouTube or on TED Talks, that if you can shorten it in 10 minutes, I will promote it personally within my company. I think you're right. It is a behavioral change everybody can make to have conservation of energy. We can make it happen. Just a comment, thank you.
Thank you very much, thank you. Thanks.
Jan?
Thanks very much, thanks for that. I was very interested in your graphs that quantify the reduction in energy use and very impressively over those bar charts. But it seems to be tailing off, so how do you sustain that reduction and is it, or do you just, are you coming to a point where, well, that's it, you know, we can go no further and everybody's done what they can and we stop. And is it that big jump, the first initial jump? Is that the big gain? How do we quantify that?
Okay. That's actually an excellent question and something that I'm particularly proud of. That first big jump you see there was we made a major change in our SAG mill. We changed the discharge grate size in our SAG mill and we got an 11 gigawatt hour per year saving just from that one thing, which was one of the bigger drops we had there. Every year, we set the target initially of 5% savings. We then dropped that to 2% savings, and then we keep dropping that percentage each year. But the amazing thing is that we keep finding so much low-hanging fruit. It's still out there. It's amazing. On a day-to-day basis, we're finding things which are going to help us save more and more energy. We recently started an initiative. We started this year. We found that we can reduce diesel consumption by 300,000 liters a year, and compared to the techs of the world, that's not very much, but for us, that's 3.5 gigawatt hours per year, which is a substantial percentage of our diesel consumption. I don't think we're going to get those big drops again. We may find incremental drops in performance, and that to me is showing that the ISO 50001 system is working. We've focused on it, we've focused on the areas, we're identifying areas for energy performance improvement, and we're addressing those. And it's going to become more and more of a challenge to iron this out. When we've got to a point where we have eliminated as much of the unnecessary waste as possible, we'll then start looking to things like renewables to say, okay, how can we take that down the next notch? We're trying to focus on conservation first and everything else second. So I hope that addresses your question.
Yeah, somebody at the back there, please.
Andrew, very motivational, your excellent presentation. You mentioned that people was a critical part of your success. What will be your suggestion to change that culture, and how do you use the data to change the behavior? Because we believe that people with data change the world, and how were you able to do that? That we'd like to hear from you.
How much time have we got?
Well,
it's actually another very good question, and something a lot of people try and focus on. The big thing is to spend time talking to people and listening to what they have to say, especially in the beginning. I spend time with every single crew from every single department talking about energy management, promoting awareness. So we have the campaigns for training for our significant energy users. Every week we have an orientation, a mindset orientation, and energy is actually part of that orientation. So every new employee or contractor coming onto site sits through an energy orientation every week. We also have the usual posters around the place, particularly in the urinals. When guys are standing in the urinal, something straight in front of them, they can't help but read it. So it's a great place to put posters, and on the back of toilet doors is also a very, very good place where people can't help but see them. And those things, posters, it's talking to people, it's setting systems up to make sure everybody coming onto site undertakes training, and just constant vigilance. You can't let up. You've got to constantly keep renewing. That I spoke about PASS. Guys in their crew meetings every day ask, did we improve energy yesterday? And what can we do to improve energy today? And that's part of the morning safety system package, and that helps create that awareness and engagement as well.
Yeah. Thank you very much, Andrew. I mean, we're going to have to close the Q&A session here. Thank you again for this full of energy presentation, and I think a lot of people appreciated it. So thank you very much once again for this presentation.